The Duterte clan being dragged into controversies, hounding their close ally, controversial Pastor Apollo Quiboloy. During the resumption of the Senate hearing on alleged crimes committed by Quiboloy, one witness claimed former President Rodrigo Duterte and his daughter, Vice President Sara Duterte, would visit the religious leader's property to get a bag full of guns. The Duterte camp has yet to respond to the allegations.
Sa Glory Mountain po, pag dumadating po si Quiboloy, sakay ng chopper, may dala po siyang mga malalaking bag na laman po ay mga iba't ibang uri ng baril. At nilalatag po ito sa tent, nakatabi po ng mansion niya. Minsan po pumupunta din po doon si former President Rodrigo Duterte at former Mayor, Davao Mayor Sara Duterte. At pag umaalis na po sila doon sa Glory Mountain, dala na po nila yung mga bag. Na siya pong bag na nilalagyan po ng mga baril.
Meanwhile, Senator Rizzo Ontiveros, who is leading the probe, calls on the Justice Department to issue an immigration lookout bulletin order for Quiboloy. Despite a subpoena issued against the pastor, Quiboloy's camp maintains he is not required to attend the Senate hearings.
Nagiging tenor na o tema ng mga usapin dito or is whether or not si Pastor Quiboloy ay guilty of certain crimes. Ito pong mga question na ito ay nadesisyonan na po ng ating piskalya at meron pong pending na kaso sa Estados Unidos. So, para sa amin po ay hindi po in aid of legislation ito. What legislation do they want to formulate out of this a kind of inquisitorial system of inquiry?
The Philippine House of Representatives also issued a subpoena for Pastor Apollo Quiboloy. The House Committee on Legislative Franchises is probing alleged violations committed by the Sunshine Media Network International. Quiboloy has snubbed the committee's first two hearings. Many believe Quiboloy owns SMNI, but the network's lawyers deny this. The next House hearing is scheduled on March 12th. Failure to attend that hearing may lead to a contempt citation against Quiboloy. Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri shrugging off a rumored plot to oust him from his post. For him, the rumors are only meant to discredit the Senate, but Zubiri says it is up to the Senate majority to decide if they want to replace him. Zubiri has been Senate President since 2022.
I am extremely honored to serve at the pleasure of my colleagues. Ganun lang naman yan. I leave it to the wisdom of my majority. Nalaman ko pa yan last week pa. So sa amin, trabaho lang kami. We'll just focus on the job at hand and we'll not lose sight of the most important thing, which is to help the Filipino people.
Members of the Senate majority also quashing the rumors.
Wala mo naririnig. Sa totoo lang, walang may gusto nung na maging Senate President. Ang hirap ng trabaho, naiipit ka lagi. Hindi na papag-usapan. Okay naman siya.
Timing medyo off. Talagang off, we would say. But as far as I'm concerned, and as far as the members of the majority na nakausap natin the past, 24 hours, talagang we are all solidly behind our inspirational leader, Senator Mig Zubiri.
Over now to charter change, Philippine House leaders file a resolution similar to a Senate proposal to limit amendments to the Constitution to economic provisions. RG Cruz reports.
These House leaders filed resolution of both houses number 7 as a counterpart to the Senate's resolution of both houses number 6 for economic charter change. The resolution aims to empower Congress to regulate foreign investment limits in public utilities, educational institutions, and advertising. This mirrors the Senate's resolution to facilitate its passage while eliminating doubts that it will piggyback political amendments.
It will give Congress the discretion to adjust the percentage of ownership, pwedeng i-relax o pwedeng restrict.
Ito, parehong-pareho na. Constituent Assembly, exactly the same economic provision that the Senate has filed. So, siguro para wala na ibang pangamba.
Instead of referring it to the House Committee on Constitutional Amendments, House leaders are looking into constituting the House into a committee of the whole to make deliberations more inclusive.
If you will also point out the difference, in the House, we will possibly convene as a whole, no? So it will be more exhaustive and participatory despite the fact that we are a bigger chamber. But if you will look at the Senate's strategy, subcommittee, committee, roadshow, plenary, I mean, kayo na po ang mag-discuss. Kayo na po, in your mind, why?
The lawmakers maintain the resolution is not to railroad charter change because this has been a running discussion across several congresses. They also defend the timing of the move since they are nearly done with all of the government's priority bills. While they want to finish this as soon as possible, they don't know yet if they can approve it before the Holy Week break.
We have more or less 3 months, 4 months na mapag-usapan to sa pinakamabilis, exhaustive na paraan kung saan inclusive ito sa lahat ng mga stakeholders.
Congressman Albano urges both chambers to just come together in a constituent assembly.
I challenge both houses of Congress to begin this debate and then start to constitute ourselves to a constituent assembly to finally begin amending this archaic 4-decade-old 1987 Philippine Constitution.
The Senate resumes its deliberations on RB 86. Albano also joined Senator Panfilo Lacson in saying lawmakers have no role in a distribution. This after the Ayuda para sa Kaposang Kita program was dragged into the People's Initiative controversy.
Hindi lang sa hindi obligasyon ng mga senador at kongresista ang mag-distribute ng tupad, aeks at kung ano-ano pa. Illegal yan, bawal yan.
Albano, however, sees nothing wrong if lawmakers join the executive in aid distribution.
We have oversight and we will be there to see whether or not the funds that we allocated, the law that created ACAP, is enforced to the T, to the law.
Senator Amy Marcos clarifies why she was present in the aid distribution of the Department of Social Welfare and Development.
Yung DSWD, sila naman ang talagang namimili. Wala naman akong pakialam dyan, pati yung LG. Hindi naman kami nanghihimasok sinong ililista.
Lacson stands by his statement, insisting the DSWD should be left to distribute aid with local government units only in a supporting role. RG Cruz, ABS-CBN News.
A strong denial from China on the alleged use of cyanide by Chinese fishermen in the Philippine waters. Beijing's embassy in Manila calls the allegations baseless and sheer fabrication. It also claims Bajo de Masinloc, which it calls Huang Yan Dao, also belongs to China. The embassy adds the groundless speculations place doubt on the professionalism of Philippine government agencies. It then urged Manila to handle maritime issues seriously and meet Beijing halfway in maintaining peace and stability in the South China Sea. The National Security Council, looking into the report of the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources, or BFAR, on China's alleged cyanide fishing. The NSC says while it is deeply concerned about the report, there is a need to validate the claims. The BFAR earlier said information on the alleged use of cyanide by Chinese fishermen in Bajo de Masinloc came from Filipino fisherfolk in the area.
Kami po dito sa National Security Council, we are alarmed by this development na nangyayaring ito. Mm-hmm. But we have to be careful also. So we have to validate and investigate. Mm-hmm. So ang sabi po namin sa DFAR, complete the documentation that you have taken, no? Yung mga ebidensya at mga affidavits na makukuha natin, submit your post-mission report to the National Task Force West Philippine Sea. We will investigate this report.
Fisherfolk group Pamalakaya, meanwhile, says Filipino fishermen have long reported China's cyanide fishing, but no action was taken to stop it.
Dapat ang kasuhan, hindi lang yung mga mangisda, no? Mga Chinese, kundi pati yung gobyerno ng China, kasi kinuudyukan or pinapayagan nila, no? Nagawin ang kanilang mga fishermen yung pagsira sa ating pangisdaan, no? Ang paggamit ng illegal na paraan ng panghuhuli ng isda, lalo-lalo na itong napakasindihan, no? Yung epekto ng cyanide.
6 Philippine soldiers killed in a weekend clash with the militants linked to last December's deadly bombing at the Mindanao State University. 4 soldiers were also wounded in the encounter, while 3 members of the Daula Islamiyah Maote group were killed. Armed Forces Chief Romeo Browner Jr. extended his condolences to the families of the slain soldiers. Sunday's clash took place in Munay, Lanao del Norte. Philippine troops have so far killed 18 Daula Islamiyah Maote group members, including the militant known as the Engineer, who was the alleged mastermind of the MSU bombing. The December 3rd bomb attack on a Catholic mass at the MSU gym killed 4 people and wounded dozen others. The Philippine Senate approves the proposed 100 peso daily minimum wage hike for private sector workers on third and final reading. The bill exempts businesses that have fewer than 10 employees and have a startup capital of 3 million pesos. Senate Majority Leader Joel Villanueva believes the legislated wage hike will have minimum impact on inflation. Villanueva is confident it will not result to layoffs. Several House lawmakers and groups earlier warned a private sector wage hike may put a strain on micro, small, and medium enterprises. Let's now get an update on the weather from PAGASA forecaster Lori De La Cruz. Hi, Lori.
Good morning, Ms. Petina, and to all our viewers and listeners. Right now, easterlies is affecting the eastern section of the country, and it's causing cloudy skies with rains and thunderstorms over Caraca and southern Leyte. But here in Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we will experience generally fair weather apart from localized thunderstorms. And as of today, we're not monitoring any LPA or a tropical cyclone inside the Philippine area of responsibility, and we're not expecting at least in the next 2 to 3 days. This is the latest from PAGASA. This is Lori De La Cruz.
Thank you very much for that update, Lori.